I call upon this agenda meeting of the Freeholder Board to order. Clerk of the Board, please call the roll.
Freeholder Carter.
Present.
Freeholder Estrada.
Present.
Freeholder Hudak.
Here.
Freeholder Jalo.
Here.
Freeholder Kowalski.
Here.
Freeholder Mirabella.
Present.
Freeholder Wright.
Present.
And Chairman Granados.
Here.
Chairman, you have 8 freeholders present.
Clerk of the Board, please call, lead us in prayer and salute to the flag.
Humbly, we ask God, the giver of peace and the lover of charity, to give the entire family of nations true agreement with his will and to grant the light of his spirit on all who work for justice and peace. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We'll approve communication at the December 21st regular meeting. At this time, I'd like to call upon Freeholders Jalo and Wright for tonight's presentation, recognizing some of the great youth and talents we have here in Union County.
Chairman Granados?
Yes.
If I may, can I, I'll read the statement of
statement
compliance
with
the
sir.
Open Public Meetings Act.
Go for it.
The chair wishes.
I'm testing you out, Jimmy.
The chair wishes to announce that pursuant to the requirements of New Jersey statutes annotated Title 10, Chapter 4, Section 10 of the Open Public Meetings Act, adequate notice of this meeting of the Board of Chosen Freeholders of the County of Union has been given by mailing the annual meeting schedule for the year 2017, along with periodic changes necessitated by circumstances, to the newspapers circulating within the County of Union who are designated to receive such notice, and by posting the annual meeting schedule for the year 2017 in the Administration Building, and further by following the annual meeting schedule for the year 2017 with the Office of the County Clerk.
Thank you. Now I'd like to call upon Freeholder Jalo and Wright. Presentation, please.
Thank you, Chairman. Hello, everyone.
Hello, Freeholder.
How you doing? How's everything?
There you go. little class participation here. All right.
Great day today?
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you.
Good job.
Thanks,
good
job. Thank you. Every so often, we have the honor of paying tribute to a stellar young individual in our community who is doing excellent things. And on this day, the person receiving that honor is Deja Edmond of Burnett Middle School. So that's from Union, right? Also known as Deja Vu. Please come up. I want you guys all to know about her. Deja Vu is now 12 years old. Are you 12 now? Okay. And she sold 1,000 copies of her book, Uniquely Made, Girls Don't Play Football. Right?
Wow. Nice.
Exactly. We have an author right here. Right here. And this is a book that was released in December 2016 when she was 11, telling the story of how constantly, or after being constantly told that she couldn't play football, that she not only made the Pop Warner team, but played for 3 years.
All right.
Right, so it's fantastic. She doesn't stop there. She has a second book. I'll let her talk about it in a few. But I just want you guys to know, she's been honored. She's been on ABC 7, New York, with Sandra Bookman. She was featured in Spotlight, New Jersey. New Jersey News 12 with Dela Cruz. She's been interviewed for her book, Book Lover Only, on Rebel Radio and Married to the Game. And she's a fantastic young person who we're no doubt gonna see excellent things from for years to come. And so I'm gonna give the microphone to her so she can tell us a little bit about herself and her book.
Hi, everybody.
Hi.
First, I wanna thank Freeholder Jalo for having me and Freeholder Ms. Wright for having me. My second book is titled Hair Chronicles, The Struggle of Natural Hair. It's about how I hate getting my hair done, and every time my mother told me I had to go get my hair done, I would throw a tantrum or just hide or act like I was asleep. So that way I just could not get my hair done. I hated it. And I basically wrote about how I just really, really hated getting my hair done, and I wanted everybody to know how I felt about getting my hair done, and if anybody could relate to it. Pretty sure some people in here could relate to it. I wrote this book right here, unique title, Uniquely Made Girls Don't Play Football, when I was 11 years old, and I just wanted to inspire my peers that you can do whatever you want. Don't let people bring you down because of who you are or your skin color or anything else or your gender. And I just wanted my peers to know, like, you are who you are. You can't change it. And, like, just do what you put your mind to. Thank you.
Let me ask you this question. Is there anyone in this room who's responsible, in addition to, you know, you and your mind and your, you know, I'm going to write a book now about not wanting to shave my beard. That's pretty impressive, by the way. I like that. Beard Chronicles, right? But no, anyone else who's responsible for your success in this room that you want to thank at this moment?
My mother, Melinda Sally, she's right there with and my sister for also encouraging me.
Also, while I'm up here talking, my purpose here is to give you this resto on behalf of this resolution, on behalf of the Board of Chosen Freeholders, a small token of an acknowledgement of the amazing things you're doing in our community here.
Sergio there. Okay, smile. This is suitable for framing. I just say he's ahead of his time. I gotta get Al to smile a little bit, the other Al. Oh, isn't everybody? My wife is the same.
She's got over this thing too.
My wife.
I just want to take this opportunity to thank Freeholder Jollof, because we have to let our young generation know that we're behind them. It takes a village to raise these children, and I'm very impressed with the things that my daughter's doing. She just got honored at the Devils hockey game the other day. She got the Walmart playmaker of the game, and I'm really proud of what she's doing, and her young peers, they really gravitate to her because she's honest and they can relate to her. And I thank you guys once again for supporting what the young people are doing.
Now I'd like to call upon Deputy County Clerk Dorado on behalf of the Office of the Union County Clerk.
Good evening, Chairman, members of the Board. The Office of the County Clerk has 10 resolutions for your consideration this evening. I'd be very happy to answer any questions you have.
Anyone have any questions? Good. Thank you very much.
Okay.
You want me to ask a question?
I think she wants a question. That seems like.
I was just getting ready. You looked ready to ask a question.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I have a question. Can you go into particularly excruciating detail on number 9, please?
Number 9?
Yeah, the purpose for that.
So the county clerk's office went through a open and public process to acquire proposals from, solicit proposals from qualified vendors to provide printing services for our elections. B&B Press was pre-qualified as a responsible and responsive vendor to provide those services. They provide our vote-by-mail ballots and our provisional ballots. This is a two-year contract, which will represent the primary and general elections for 2018 and 2019. And we've also built into the contract a provision for to special elections. So in the event they have them, we're covered by the contract and we don't have to come back before the board.
Mr. Chairman, I'm not surprised that she's so well prepared. Nice job.
Thank you, Fairley.
Can you elaborate on number three, please?
Yes, I'd be very happy to. The county clerk's five-year plan is a statutory requirement which outlines the priorities of the county clerk's trust fund. The county clerk's trust fund is funded, again, it's a statutory mechanism wherein $2 for every document that's recorded in our office is directed to the trust fund. The limitations on the trust fund are also statutory. They include technical advancements in our office, election matters and election enhancements in our office, as well as education. So we have a number of priorities that we've outlined in the plan, which include back scanning so that our documents can go back to 1977, allowing the public to do almost a 40-year title search on our website. Our app, our election app, the advertising and design is funded through that program. Like I said, education, conferences, technological infrastructures. All a few years ago, we had to purchase new servers. That was funded through the trust fund.
Thank you very much, Deputy County Clerk Dorado. Freeholder Estrada.
Thank you very much. Now that you brought up an issue, you said about that you'll be looking to scan back to 1977 of all the titles. Does the individual from the community have the access to look at the whole part of the record, or only the first two pages, or what's the? Because I know there's a fee associated to some of the lookups.
There's no fee.
No fee?
There's no fee. Our website is absolutely free. You don't have to sign up. You can go online. There are all public documents. Right now, our deeds and mortgages go back to the 80s, so we have three more years to scan to get them ready for the website. However, you can come into our records room and you can search anything back to 1857, the inception of the county.
Free of charge.
Free of charge. We can even show you how to do it.
Oh, wow. I'm coming.
I'll prepare the staff.
thank you very much.
Any other questions? Thank you very much.
Thank you. Have a good evening.
Let's call upon Tom Cowdrey on behalf of the Office of Union County Prosecutor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Board of Freeholders, the Prosecutor's Office has five items on the agenda. I'd be happy to answer any questions you may have.
Are there any questions? Here, the Kowalski.
If you could tell us a little bit about the shelving and number five. Seems kind of pricey, but I guess it's a specialized kind of shelving that we need for the laboratory?
Yes, currently at the lab, which I have actually personal knowledge of, I served as the interim lab director for a while, and we have a big problem with storage. As you may or may not know, the evidence has to be kept for quite some time, some of it indefinitely, mm-hmm. both on the biology side, the CDS side, not as bad. What we currently have now is static shelving, which is just rows of steel shelves with wood on top of those. Over the past year and a half to 2 years, we've seen about a 30% increase in cases submitted to the lab. We are running out, pretty much out of space, and that's with doing all the destruction that we can legally do. This shelving here is it's collapsible shelving. It's a mechanical assist, so when you have normal static shelving, you need a walkway, an alleyway, so to speak, in between each set of shelves. These shelves here actually collapse upon each other. So we'll gain between the two storage rooms, we'll gain over 70% storage space in one and over 80% in another. It is rather pricey, but it's a rather complex system and it's quite involved.
Could I also ask, I would suppose that the newer shelving helps in extending the life that we get of evidence as well, or is that doesn't relate to it?
It will help as far as not extending the life of the evidence. The evidence is going to have the life that it's going to have, but what it will do, I guess you could contribute and say that it would extend the life of the evidence or the packaging that's in the evidence. If you're using the static shelving and you're piling things on top of each other, year after year, you may get some crushing, some damaging. Right. It's quite possible. I don't know of any cases where we have that, but I have personally experienced the problem with the storage out there.
Thank you.
Freeholder Schroeder?
Yes, so apparently the disability will allow you to expand in terms of your space, but how much time will that give us? I mean, is that only good enough for the next 5 years, or do we need to look beyond 5 years to try to find out another means of storing?
Well, not knowing if we'll continue to get an increase in submissions to the lab, but based upon the rate of the submissions and what we're getting now, and if we keep up with a healthy destruction schedule of the CDS evidence, obviously not biology evidence, I see this taking us for many years. For me to be able to nail it down to 5 more years or 7 more years, if I were to do that and we start to see, you know, especially with all these different strains of different drugs coming out constantly, if we see 50-70% increase in submissions, that would, you know, cut back on the amount of storage space that we would have and the amount of years that we can, you know, see into the future to store it. But if we stay where we're at now submission wise, it'll take us many years into the future.
Okay. Is this county dollars or this is forfeiture funds? Forfeiture funds. Thank you very much.
Any other questions? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I'd call Director Yeska from the Department of Administrative Services.
Good evening, Mr. Chair and fellow freeholders. The department has 11 for your consideration. 9 are yearly renewals for HR and personnel contracts that we do every year. 1 is a housekeeping account change on a resolution. And 1 is a placeholder for a contract for a health benefits broker that the committee is still deliberating and gathering information for, and we will be giving you individual reports on that information after the committee makes its recommendation.
Are there any questions from the Freeholder Board? Freeholder Marabella?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Director, for number 6, I see we are renewing our employee assistance program, which I think is terrific, and employees that need that service, it's available to them. I'm interested in the usage and the numbers. You don't have to give it to me now unless you have it in front of you. But I would be interested to see how many people are using it and the fact that it is being used, number of calls, number of referrals, whatever, certainly no details, just overall numbers would be helpful for me to understand its use.
Sure, if you could, introduce you first. This is my highly competent director of personnel that you all know, and she's a little bit nervous as she is the first time. She did not bring donuts.
And that is kind of a thing, right?
But she is prepared with the numbers that you want to ask, so I'll refer to you. So you say, through you, Mr. Chairman.
Through you, Mr. Chairman. The last quarter between July 1st to September 30th, we saw 487 employees actually use the program, which is 20% of our workforce.
And that's just for one quarter's worth?
Yeah, one quarter.
So you could say that, is that, do you think that's reflective of the usage in the first quarter, the second quarter?
It's
so that's
the highest out of the third quarter.
All right, good. Well, that gives me a good perspective on the that one quarter, but if you can give me at some point, you don't have them in front of you, that's fine, a year-to-date number and maybe a prior year number, just to get a perspective. And I'm just happy that this board sees fit to provide this opportunity and a program for employees that need it. So it's a good thing. Thank you.
Also, through you, Mr. Chairman, and one of the things that we realize is that wellness is very important. So overall, with regard to the health of our employees, we try to encourage them to utilize the services that the Freeholder Board has provided for their use and actually not even wait until there's a crisis situation, but something that might be a small problem before it turns into a large one. So really, everyone does appreciate the support this board provides.
Good. Thank you, Al.
Any fear the corner?
Yes. Can you go into number 3 a little bit in reference to the maintenance coverage?
Yes. excuse me just a second. Let me just get to the right page. So what the equipment maintenance policy allows us to do, and we've had it now for 15 years. I used to monitor it when I was the purchasing agent. As you know, the county has a diverse amount of equipment, and
used to be now it works tonight. Wow.
I
don't have a pacemaker, so I don't know why that happened.
Robert, where's Robert? He probably did it.
Is this off
you
now?
Do that, Robert? No,
okay. So we have a diverse amount of things. So what this allows us to do is, if we had to do contracts with all the vendors that could fix our machine, we would have hundreds of contracts. So what we do instead is we hire an underwriter. And that underwriter charges us a certain fee, like a warranty, an extended warranty, on all of that equipment. And that not only do they do that, but they make sure that we're not overcharged, that we're not charged for anything like travel charges. At one point, they tried to charge us a technician to come from California to fix this DNA machine for the prosecutor's lab. The prosecutor's lab takes up $65,000 worth of this insurance, and they have spectrographs and all very intricate machines, and it's very worthwhile. They believe in this, the way to do it this way, so that we have an expert to say, wait a minute, you're overcharging us. Wait a minute, you can't charge us for this. So this year
deals with all of our equipment throughout the counties, not just, or is it specific areas?
No, it's throughout the county for anything that isn't under warranty. So our computers and our printers are usually under warranty, and by the time that they reach obsolescence, it's almost better to replace them. So we don't have any of those on. We have a lot of the print shop machines are on. I think it's about $15,000 for the large banner makers and things like that. And we also feel like we're saving money by doing it this way also.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions? Thank you, Mr. Director.
Thank you.
Now I'd like to call upon Director Charles from the Department of Corrections.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. Department of Corrections has 7 resolutions for your consideration. I'll try to answer any questions you may have.
Any Freeholder have any questions? Freeholder Marabella.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Director, I see many of these are for religious ministry.
Yes.
For our inmates. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I'm just wondering why we can find people only from Union County to provide the service. Is it professional service? How do we find maybe they're rolling over year after year, but for Jewish services or Christian services or Muslim services? But is there any reason why we have to go outside of the county for some of these services?
We do have some in county who volunteer. These particular Catholic, Islamic, and Protestant have been at the jail for the past 8 to 10 years. And they provide the services. They understand the security of the institution. They understand the rules that we have to govern. So it seems to be a working process, but certainly we're not excluding anyone from Union County. So if we have an entity or a service that we can, I would certainly move to have them as well.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Freeholder Carter.
Can you go into number 6 and a little bit into number 7?
Sure. Number 6. Is for the automation of reports at the jail. Currently, we do not have an automation system. We do everything pretty much by pen and paper. Some of the suggestions that came out of the audits this year that we had was to start moving into the automation system. And this system is basically taking all of our incident reports, our grievance reports, and automating all of that into one management system so that one, at a push of a button, if I need to know information, I can have it in front of me. And if any reports are desired, I can just pull it off the system without having to take days or hours to research it. And number 7 is the annual contract at the youth house, detention center. We have a memorandum of understanding with Hudson County for the superintendent, Diana Yost.
Any other questions? Thank you, Mr. Arthur. I'd like to call upon Deputy County Manager Wagner on behalf of the Department of Economic Development.
Good evening, Chairman, members of the Freeholder Board. The Department of Economic Development has 7 resolutions for your consideration, and I'd be happy to answer any questions you may have.
Anyone have any questions? Freeholder Estrada?
Yes. Ms. Wagner, on number 7, could you go a little more in detail on that? I don't understand why we're doing this. I mean, why are we hiring the Utilities Authority to do maintenance on equipment?
We're not hiring them. They're hiring us, actually. We provide a shared service to help monitor their website. Our webmaster assists them as needed, and they pay us $250 a month to do that service.
So this is from the right pocket to the left pocket? Because we probably pay up anyway,
yes.
So.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. See, he looked at me the other way. That's why I was asking the question. But.
Yes. Any other questions? Thank you very much, Deputy Manager. I call upon Director Graziano from Department of Engineering, Public Works, and Facilities Management.
Good evening, Chairman, Freeholders. I have 13 resolutions on for your consideration tonight. I'll be happy to answer any questions, but before that, I'd like to, if I can, through you, Mr. Chairman, there's just a couple of resolutions I'd like to speak to before you ask me any questions. Resolution number four, if you look at that one, that's almost $7 million that we're getting state aid. That's the most we've gotten in the last bunch of years. We usually get between $3 and $4 million. This is all directly related to the gas tax that we've had. That one, and also number 5, 6, 7, and 8, typically those four total $2.2 million that we will be getting. The last few years we've only gotten $1 million, so that's been doubled. And then number 9 is actually a new grant opportunity through the TTF. That's the only one here that we are applying. I mean, the other ones we will be getting. This one's an application. I think they're giving out $30 million to the whole state, and we're applying for $750,000, and that's through the TTF. That's for like port for any roads that are that have any roads leading to any ports or warehouse distribution centers. In this case, Lower Road goes down towards. Towards Tremley, and you have some warehouses down there, and there's also some bridge numbers on there. So that's what we were able to apply for that one. So this is a new application that we have, and then in so those are the grant stuff that I want to talk about. And then in number 11, that's a bid that we went out to bid for the jury waiting room for $359,000. All you remember that we have to start that whole new stair tower project for the courthouse. We went out to bid a couple weeks ago for that. We have a low bidder. We haven't awarded that project yet. But part of that project will be going through the existing jury room. With this, between our staff and through the contractor, we're going to be doing all this work up there. The contractor's doing some of the work, and we are also doing some of the work in-house. Just some numbers on the old jury room only held 160 people and only had one form of egress and no restrooms. This new one, which is downstairs in the new annex, is going to hold 260 jurors. It'll have bathrooms, and it's all-new HVAC. The contractor's doing the HVAC. Some of the piping has to go up to the penthouse, and also the fire suppression. We're going to be doing all the ceiling work, all the walls, all the trim work, and everything else just to help cut down the cost. We have a great carpenter staff with all the trades as well that are going to help with that. With that going through, so I just wanted to touch on those because those are very important, and I'll be happy to answer any questions you have on the other ones or those.
Thank you very much. Any of you have any questions? Just want to commend you and your staff on reference to number 11, and making sure that you're looking at ways to cut down costs through your own staff. So commend you guys on that great work.
And also just through you, our in-kind. Work on this will probably total about $314,000. So, and that's between all the work that we're going to be doing. Most of it's going to be like the electronic safety stuff like that. With the contractor at 354, 359, whatever that number is, and we're at 314, so we're basically splitting the work with the contractor. So it's really going to come out good.
Thank you very much, sir, right there.
You're welcome. Thank you, Chair.
Freeholder Schroeder?
No, I'm just trying to understand number 11 in terms of this has happened, 216, the resolution 216-035. How much did we allocate then? The same amount that's there, 359,800?
Yes. Hold on one second. Let me just pull that one out, and if not, I'll get to the answer in a little while. I don't know what the 216 one is. Tom, what was the 216?
That's the engineering number.
Yeah, that's not a resolution. That's just our our project number that we have it tagged in engineering.
Right, but doesn't that mean that that was originally stated in the year 2016?
No, it's probably when we started talking about the project doing it, so that's when Tom numbers the project through engineering.
So when you start talking, you give it a number, huh?
Excuse me?
When you start talking about it, you give it a number?
Yes. Yes.
All right, what's the bridge number for Hillside?
Which bridge?
The one you're going to put the lights on.
I think it's 10-1-35 over. That one goes over the brook between Union and Hillside.
Okay.
And we ordered those parts for that bridge, just so you know.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome, sir.
Any other questions? Thank you very much, Director Griffin.
Thank you, Chairman.
Director Taylor, behalf of the Department of Finance.
I would have thought would have made it up.
I would have made it up.
Yeah. How do you prove wrong?
Good evening, Chairman and members of the board. The Department of Finance has 5 resolutions for your consideration this evening, and I'd be happy to answer any questions you have.
Is there any questions from the Freeholder board? Thank you, Mr. Director Taylor.
Thank you.
Director Debbie Ann Anderson, behalf of the Department of Human Services.
Good evening, Chairman and members of the board. The Department of Human Services has 15 resolutions for your consideration. I'll be happy to answer any questions you may have.
Do any freeholders have any questions? Thank you very much, Director. Director, Division Director, Armando Sanchez.
Good evening, Chairman, Freeholders Board. I have 9 resolutions on for your consideration tonight. I'll try and answer as many of those questions as I possibly can.
Any questions from the Freeholder Board?
Oh, yeah, I got a couple. I know that it's in your area there, the actual calling of the deer management, I guess number 8. No, number 8 is a caucus. Which is the one that that Dan Bernier is going to be involved in?
Dan is here to discuss.
I know. That's my next first question. You stand by because I have a question for you too. Dan, when are you going to be doing Hillside? I'm the rep for Hillside nowadays.
Members of the board.
We need to hunt in Hillside.
Mr. Freeholder, I anticipated your question. I've continued to look at that situation in Hillside.
Continue to look? That doesn't.
Well, no. Director Zuber and I were discussing it last week. In all of the locations that we have hunted, where we currently have hunting programs in Union County, other than the Watchung Reservation, they all originated with a request from the town. So though all I know, you're getting complaints from one or more residents there, and I've taken
more than a
few calls as well.
Numerous.
Yeah.
So in the area of 9 or 10.
Yeah. I've looked at the topography there, and it's not going to be an easy situation to deal with because there's not a lot of wooded space. But there may be an opportunity to do something as similar to what we're doing in Plainfield now, using archery equipment. But if there would be a way to get the Township of Hillside to request our involvement, that would certainly be a good way to start.
So in order for you to act, you need to have the Township request it.
Well, I'm only saying that is the way
it has
happened.
So the future, I can tell the people, instead of complaining to me, go complain to your Township so they can take care of it.
It would be a good first step for them to get their township to support the idea of us coming into their town with this kind of program.
Okay. And you're doing also Plainfield as well, because there's a lot of complaints in Plainfield as well about
yes, there is a program. The City Council of Plainfield approved the program this past Monday evening, I believe. So that program will be starting shortly.
Okay.
Any other questions?
Yes, I do have another question. There was only one. Number 9, sir, could you go in detail why are we paying $853,000 as a change order for the Warren Ankle Park ice skating renovation?
Through you, Mr. Chairman. We've been working on the change order now since April when we began to start to close out the project. This is the final change order, the only change order that we're going to have to close out the Warren Ankle project. 84% roughly of the $853,000 that we're requesting for the change order is directly related to unforeseen conditions. Conditions such as unsuitable soils that we ran into when we were actually excavating and beginning to set the foundations for the new building. With that alone was over $200,000 that we were looking at in order to stabilize the site to support the building. That was something that we could not foresee in design and engineering. Obviously, we had an operation that was already existing, so we did not know what was underneath that building. Also, too, when we began to upgrade our electrical systems, it was determined by PSE&G that we did not have sufficient load to go ahead and run our systems in the building. Even though we designed the building based on code and it was engineered the way with the systems out, the loads that we had available to us, they requested that we actually upgrade our system so that we do not cause future problems when we were actually running the building. Also, we ran into the same very similar situation with our water supply. The water company asked us to actually bring in a separate line off the street to go ahead and support the new building so that we can separate not only our potable water but also our fire suppression systems and not run it off the same main that was running our chiller system. So overall, between engineering, myself, and working with the contractor, we looked at it and we thought it was in the best interest of the county and the building to go ahead and upgrade these systems and do these changes so that we obviously run the building more efficiently and actually for the long-term health of the operation itself.
Okay, would you be able to give me a breakdown? How much was the dirt? How much was the electricity? How much
was
the water?
Electrical upgrade was about $224,000. Unsuitable soils was roughly around $190,000. And then our water upgrade with our new hot box and main and also fire suppression line was $146,000. That all comes out to about $530,000. Then we also had, with these changes, we also ran into some delays, which also caused us to pick up a delay claim from the contractor, something that we actually was going to be higher than what he had requested. What we're working with the contractor and negotiating it down, we actually lowered the number down by half of what his claim was.
So the difference of from 530 to 853,
and then plus
which
the $200,000 claim, and then there was a $200,000 delay on the project. So that totals out to about $730,000, 84%.
Do you know if they have taken care of the issues that I have brought up in terms of the? Chimney that's up there in the middle of the floor? Did they take care of that? Did they take care of the paint?
We're still finalizing the punch list and your items that you have made very clear to myself to fix, will be fixed.
Because the papers that you provided that I asked you for in terms do not have anything to do, do not in any way state how the finished product should look. Which
right.
was a price. Normally, it's an addendum to the actual prints that tell you exactly
right.
They were not there.
That schedule is literally the finished schedule is a book that you would it'd be very intensive to go.
So who dropped the ball?
I wouldn't say anybody dropped the ball. I think the contractor. It's a very complicated project, and I think we're still not done. We're in the process of closing it out, and these detail things need to be done, and they will be taken care of.
At no cost, it's already covered here.
It's all done.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, just following up on that, I understand that there's much more usage of the new Warren Anko Center, so maybe you could tell us how the numbers have changed as far as the number of people who are using the new Warren Anko skate rink, and also so with more people coming in, you're scheduling the work so it's not going to interfere with the public?
That's one of the biggest challenges through you, Mr. Chairman. That's one of the biggest challenges right now is because we didn't really anticipate the amount of volume that we've gotten, especially on the weekends, like Friday, Saturdays, and Sunday. We're seeing right now, I know we've already exceeded our number. Our last full year when we had the rink open, when we did have the open skate and whatnot, we've already, through November, we had exceeded that number already. So we definitely see an increase. I'm not going to give you a percentage just yet. When we finish out the year, I'll have that for you. But there is a significant increase. And one of the things that we are seeing is a lot of our local, you know, the 15, 16, 17-year-olds, that's really become the place, especially in the area, the place for them to basically hang out on the weekends, which is, I think it's something that we all envisioned it to be. And the challenge is to try to get all this work done while we do have the operation going full steam ahead is a little challenging. But we're staying on top of the contractor. He's actually our contractor that is not at Ashbrook, so he's not going anywhere. He's not gonna leave us basically high and dry.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Any other questions? Thank you very much. Director Moran, Department of Public Safety.
Chairman, members of the board, Department of Public Safety has 9 resolutions for your consideration. I'll try and answer any questions you may have.
Any freeholders have any questions?
Thank you very much, Director.
Thank you.
County Council, Bob Berry.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The Office of the County Council has five items on tonight's agenda, and I'd be happy to answer any questions the board may have.
Any questions? That's it. Thank you very much, County Council.
You're welcome.
County Manager, do you have any resolutions to add?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The Office of the County Manager may have one resolution on with regard to position controls.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Vice Chair, I may have two resolutions, one relative to the UCUA, one relative to the UCIA.
Any other questions?
I'd like to join Freeholder Mirabella on number 8, if that's okay.
Sure. Freeholder the card.
I'd like to also join the one number 8, and I'd also may have an additional resolution. Laudatory.
I also may have some few laudatory resolutions to add to next week's meeting. May I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you very much. Have a great night, everyone.
Not bad.
Good job.
Yeah. Armando.
Yes.